This video is about the Gilbert cell, which produces an output signal proportional to the product of two input signals. Such circuits are widely used for frequency conversion in radio systems. The advantage of this circuit is the output current is an accurate multiplication of the differential base currents of both inputs. As a mixer, its balanced operation cancels out many unwanted mixing products, resulting in a cleaner output. A typical use of Gilbert cell is in the mixer used in radio frequency, for example in the receiver where you want to get an intermediate frequency IF from the RF signal in order to properly process the signal and get a clear baseband. So you need to multiply the RF signal with the local oscillator LO signal because this product generates a translation of the frequency, the IF signal, which then can be filtered and processed. So the basic operation is an analog multiplication, and this can be very well obtained with a Gilbert cell. Indeed, the most popular active double balanced mixer topography in RF IC design is the Gilbert cell mixer. This type of mixer exploits symmetry to remove the unwanted RF and LO output signals from the IF signal by cancellation. The basic building block of the Gilbert cell is the differential amplifier. Let's remember the general working starting from the large signals. So V input is much larger than the terminal voltage VT. Let's say that VB1 is equal to VB2. In this case, if the BJT Q1 and Q2 are matched, the tail current I is equally split in the two branches of the circuit, thus producing the same voltage drop on the two equal resistor RC. So the voltage Vout equals VC2 minus VC1 is equal to zero. If we now consider a signal VB1 greater than the VB2 such that VB1 minus VB2 is much greater than the terminal voltage VT, we have that Q1 is on and Q2 is off, and the wall tail current I passes through the first branch, so VC1 is equal to VCC minus RC times I, and VC2 is equal to VCC. For example, if you assume that VB1 is 3 volts and VB2 is 2 volts, the point P is at 3 minus 0.7 volts, so it is at 2.3 volts. And since VB2 is at 2 volts, Q2 must be off. The reasoning is similar with the small signal, but in this case, when the input signal is much less than the thermal voltage, we don't switch off one of the two transistors. Both transistors are on, but if, for example, as we see in the schematic, VB1 is greater than VB2, then a greater current must flow through the first branch in respect to the second, thus unbalancing the current in the two branches. According to the small signal analysis, the imbalance in the current is equal to GmVd, where Gm is the transconductance of the two transistors, assuming them matched, and Vd is the difference between VB1 and VB2, or the differential input voltage. So, if Vd is different from zero, it's as if plus Vd half is applied to Q1 and minus Vd half is applied to Q2, thus creating a current imbalance of GmVd. So the output voltage is GmVd times RC. The output voltage is proportional to the input voltage Vd and to Gm, but Gm is proportional to the tail current I, and this is a key factor in the Gilbert cell. Vice versa, if Vd is equal to zero, the BJT bases have the same voltages, then the tail current I is split in half in the two branches, and Vout is equal to zero. Note that in any case the total current remains I regardless of the input voltages. The point P acts as virtual ground and any common input is cancelled because the circuit can sense only the differential voltage in input if the transistor and the resistor are matched. Now we add another differential amplifier cross-connecting the inputs and connecting the output the way you see in the schematic. The two differential amplifiers are biased by the tail current IA and IB. Let's see the behavior of the circuit. If the transistors are matched and VIN1 is equal to zero, the tail currents split equally on the branches of the differential amplifier. So here flows IB half and here flows IA half. So the voltage drops on the resistance RC are these ones, and they are equal no matter of the value of the tail currents IB and IA. So Vout is equal to 0 if the input voltage is 0. Let's see now what happens if V1 is different from 0 and IA is equal to IB, but let's see it in a quality way considering the large signal behavior. So if V1 is large, then Q2 and Q3 are on and Q1 and Q4 are off. So here flows the wall IB and here flows the wall IA. In the other branches, the current is 0, so the voltage drop on RC are these, and since IA is equal to IB, Vout is equal to 0. Now let's see the small signal case in which we assume VN1 less than the thermal voltage and IB different from IA. Let's assume that Q1 is matched with Q2, so GM1 equals GM2 equals GMA equals IA half divided by the thermal voltage. The same for Q3 and Q4, so GM3 equals GM4 equals GMB. These are the currents flowing in the circuit. You see that V1 different from 0 produces an imbalance in the currents related to GMA and GMB. The voltage drops on the RC resistor are these, and the Vout voltage is this one. It is related to Vin and to the difference between GMA and GMB. So the output voltage is proportional to the input voltage and to the difference between GMA and GMB. But remember that GMA is IA half divided by the thermal voltage VT and GMB is IB half divided VT, we have that the output voltage is proportional also to the difference of the tail currents. So from this formula also you can see that if IB is equal to IA, Vout is 0. So increasing IA in respect to IB makes the output voltage increase. So controlling this difference, we can vary the output. Now we want to control IA and IB by means of a voltage, and this can be achieved with another differential amplifier. So this is the final cell where we add Q5 and Q6 in a differential amplifier configuration. We have only one tail current I, and if Q5 and Q6 are matched, GM5 equals GM6 equals GM, which depends on the tail current I. So now the difference of the two currents IA and IB can be replaced with the difference of the current flowing the two branches of the differential amplifier Q5 and Q6, and this is simple GM times VN2. So the ultimate formula is this, and you see that the output voltage is proportional to both the input voltages. So we obtained the product of two input signals as we wanted. Moreover, using only differential amplifiers to build this cell, the final product is not affected by any common and unwanted components, thus producing a clear output. To work properly, we must guarantee the symmetry and the matching of the transistors, and this can be well done just in integrated circuits, where in addition it is not a problem to need many transistors. This portion of the circuit with the resistors is needed to transform the current in voltage, so we can use a resistor or we can use a current mirror. We can use current mirror for the tail current too, so that the circuit can be this where we use MOSFETs instead of a BJT. Here we see a Gilbert cell used as double balanced mixer for the receiver. The input of the local oscillator is this, and the RF signal is applied here, while the output at the intermediate frequency is taken here, where we have to add a circuit to transform the current in voltages. Here, instead of a receiver, we see an example of a transmitting mixer to show how the 3 MHz variable frequency oscillator or VFO is mixed with the 4 MHz to get the desired 7 MHz signal for the transmitting amplifier. So here we have the sinusoidal input VFO at 3 MHz and here the sinusoidal input at 4 MHz simulating an internal Colpitts oscillator. In the simulation we see here the Q2 collector current, which is almost a sine wave at 3 MHz, and here the collector currents of both Q6 and Q4, where you can still see the 3 MHz component. These two currents are summed together giving the current flowing in R7, in which we cannot see anymore the 3 MHz component, but we clearly see a wave shape appearing to be a combination of 1 MHz and 7 MHz sine waves. The other output would appear similar but out of phase. These output currents are translated directly into voltages by the 1500 ohm collector load resistors. Here we see the Fourier transformation of the outputs, showing the amplitude of any and all frequency components that are there. The 7 MHz and the 1 MHz signals are the biggest, but there is a murmuring mess of other frequencies too, so we need to filter the 7 MHz component. Please leave me a comment, let me know if you liked this video. Make sure you put a thumb up, click the notification bell, and subscribe to my channel.